In this next series of video lectures, we want to start looking at data in programs. We'll start by talking about variables, which are the containers for data within programs. Okay, let's get started. Variables in Java, or any other programming language for that matter, are nothing more than containers, or boxes, to hold data in our programs. A variable represents a specific location in memory, which will hold some data we need in our program. And it's named so that we can refer to that data symbolically rather than by some cumbersome memory address. For example, we'd rather refer to a certain number as numStudents rather than hex FD5E341F. Variables are program data quantities which are likely to vary over the course of execution of a program, hence their name. They can only store one value at any given point in time, but that value is free to change over the course of a program's execution. Variables in general represent three types of data in programs: inputs, outputs, and internally calculated data, or in other words, the knowns, or things we can obtain, the unknowns, and any intermediate steps needed to determine those unknowns. And wouldn't you know it, these are exactly the three general sections of code which you pseudocoded as comments within the main method of your recent program template. These three general sections of code represent a standard program flow which we'll see over and over again in your coming programs. Now, getting back to variables themselves, all variables have the following three properties: a name, a data type, and the value. Let's take a look at what we mean by these. Here we see a simple Java statement which declares an integer variable named numStudents and sets its value to 30. This is one simple executable instruction in a Java program, and we recognize it as a statement because it's terminated with a semicolon. So the name of this variable is numStudents. We've asked the compiler to set aside a piece of memory to hold this data, but although we don't know exactly where it is, we know that we can refer to it by this symbolic name. Remember that a variable name is an example of an identifier in Java, the name that we get to assign. This name meets all the requirements for the name of an identifier, and by our naming selection, it pretty strongly suggests that the purpose of the variable. I think it's pretty obvious that this refers to some number of students, maybe in a class or enrolled at some school. The data type of this variable is an int, which is one of Java's eight fundamental data types that we'll discuss in the next segment. Whenever we set up a piece of data like this, we always have to tell Java what the fundamental nature of that data will be. This tells the compiler exactly how much memory to set aside for the variable, and by extension, this tells us what the range of allowable values for this variable will be. So for example, for this variable, it's of an integer type, which simply means that it is a whole number with no decimal precision, and its range of values is up to roughly 2.1 billion. Again, we'll discuss data types in the next video lecture. Finally, the value of this variable is decimal 30. When this program statement executes, we are commanding that the binary data 00011110, or hex 1E, be stored into the memory address location referred to as numStudents. Let's take a look at the correspondence between some Java variables and their memory allocation under the hood. On the left, we see a very simple Java program inside a main method. In this example, we are first declaring three integer variables called A, B, and C. So we are asking the compiler to set aside three locations in memory big enough to hold an integer. But these three named locations will be empty at first. Next, we are initializing the values of A and B to be 4 and 5 respectively. At this point, we are storing the values 4 and 5, in binary of course, at the named addresses for A and B. Finally, we are performing a simple computation which adds the values of A and B together to get 9, and then storing that result at the named address for C, which finally gets a value assigned. One important point here And that is that the compiler decides where this data is going to live in memory, not us. We don't know, and frankly, we don't even care exactly where all this data lives. We just refer to it by the symbolic variable names A, B, and C. Also, A, B, and C aren't exactly the best variable names. Those names don't suggest anything about what this data means, so shortly we can pick better variable names than these. We'll talk about variable naming conventions a bit later on. But for now, this has been a quick introduction to what variables are and how they are represented in memory. Please continue on to the next discussion about data types.